So I'm here to talk about the reception of Occitan poetry in 16th century Italy. So let us do some contextualization first. The rediscovery of Occitan poetry in the 16th century is strictly connected with the questione della lingua, with that debate on standards and norms that was a side effect of the lack of political unity in Italy. The questione della lingua, however, also brought a new philological and historical attention to vernacular literature, and also brought with itself a new consideration of the Middle Ages that overcame that humanist behavior of complete dismissal of the Middle Ages. When investigating medieval Italian poetry, 16th century scholars inevitably came across Occitan literature. Here I have just brought the three most notable examples: the translation of Folquet in Giacomo da Lentini, the presence of passages written in Occitan in both the Commedia and the Fragmenta, and the 24 Occitan lines of the Ditta Mondo. But actually, this relationship is much deeper than that. These are just the most notable cases. Now, these rediscovery of Occitan has already been discussed in a very important book published in 1911. This is the 1995 edition by Santorre de Benedetti, Gli studi provenzali in Italia nel Cinquecento. But this book is so in depth that various commentators have said that there's not much more to say about the rediscovery of Occitan. However, in the 100 years that have passed since this book first came out, there have been multiple very important contributions that show us that there is still much to say. And here I would like to propose a couple ways a couple new perspectives to look at this matter that hopefully will bring us to new conclusions. Especially, I would like to focus on how looking in depth at specific passages in these scholars' works can reveal things about their knowledge of Occitan, and can even bring some interesting implication with itself. And I would also like to show you how the linguistic ideologies that these authors defended influenced their understanding of Occitan literature. And I would like to do so by focusing on one specific author as an example. And I've picked Pietro Bembo, who of course you will know for his work on the Aldines, as well as for the Prose. And I would like to focus specifically for the first part of this presentation on the Aldine editions of the Fragmenta and the Commedia. That is because, as we have already said, there are passages written in Occitan within these books. So I want to look at these passages to find out what we can infer about what Bembo understood and what materials were available to him at the time of these editions. And we have the manuscripts on which these editions were carried out, which is Vaticano Latino 3197. For the Fragmenta, there has already been a study by Carlo Pulzoni that has shown how much can still be said about Bembo's Occitan knowledge by looking at the Occitan line contained in the fragmenta, while the commedia has surprisingly received much less attention. So I would like to show you the passage of the commedia of Purgatorio 26, in which Dante wrote eight Occitan lines. Let us read them. This is the is Bembo's edition on 3197. Tan m'abbellis vostre courtois de man, qui eu non puos ne vuelio vos cobrire, jeu sui ernaut che plore vai cantan, con si tost vei la spassada follor, e vei jau sen loigior che sper denan, ara vus preu per aquella valor, che vus guida al som dell'escalina, sovegna vos attempts de madolor. Now, some authors have theorized that Bembo already knew Occitan quite well at this time. I think that just by looking at the second line from the bottom, we can see that this is definitely not the case. He writes Le Scalina. He uses a masculine article with a feminine name. And in general, he is very passive towards the sources that he is using here. And generally where he distances himself from the already corrupt sources that he has, he just adds more linguistic mistakes. However, there is one thing that is particularly important here, and it is this word here, tan. Indeed, if we look at his two known sources, the first word of this passage is respectively tam and tant. Now, 20 years ago, Donato Pirovano has theorized that Bembo, in establishing the text of the Commedia, also used a third source. That would be the Nido Beato edition of 1477-78. And if we go looking at this edition, we can see that we find effectively tan. However, here Bembo is picking the word that is the most distant from both Italian and Latin. And since we have already ascertained that Bembo is extremely unlikely to have known the language, we have to find an explanation for this weird textual choice. And here are two possible explanations that I found and about which I would really like to hear your feedback, because I think they're quite convincing, but at the same time, they're also quite conjectural. So let us look at the first explanation. Now, we know that Bembo, in the years when he was working on the Aldines, was very close to the Este family. And in the 1488 inventory of the Este library, we find that an Occitan manuscript, the one nowadays known as E. And this manuscript appears as Liber Fulconis de Marsiglia. Now, the name of Folquet de Marsiglia was definitely known to Bembo, even though at the time he had, as we saw, he had no knowledge of Occitan literature, as Folquet is both in the Commedia and in the Triunfi. And if we can imagine that he was, his curiosity was awakened by these words, so he went to check this book, and even though he didn't know any Occitan at all, he, on the very first page, he could find, right by a minuted initial, these words, tan mabelis. So it might be that he was aware of the existence of the expression, specifically in the version with tan. Now, let us look at the second explanation, which does not necessarily exclude the other, they're not mutually exclusive. The second explanation is connected with a friend of Bembo, Angelo Colocci, another very important 16th century philologist. Colocci and Bembo were very good friends. We have a letter from 1531 where Bembo says that il mio animo è molto vostro insino dalla giovanezza nostra. In another letter from 1539, he says that they have been friends for 40 years. And their friendship also had some consequence on their Occitan interests. Indeed, in 1582, Fulvio Orsini, long after both had died, testifies that he has seen un foglio con una lettera del cardinale Bembo al Colozio, dove gli manda i nomi di tutti i poeti provenzali e i principi di ciascuna cosa che si contiene in detto libro. Therefore, we can admit that to some extent there was that the two shared their Occitan findings. So, given this background, we know that Bembo in May 1502 was in Rome a few months before publishing the Dante. And in that same period in Rome, there was Benet Garret, a Catalan exile, who was possibly the only person to have some knowledge of Occitan at the beginning of the century. And Cariteo also owned an Occitan manuscript, and we know that he probably brought it to Rome, or at least spoke about it with Angelo Colocci. And if we go looking at his manuscript, which survives, it's the manuscript nowadays known as M, we find that same poem beginning with Tan Mabellis. So what I am proposing here is that when Bembo was in Rome, Colocci and Garret, who were aware that he was working on Dante, showed him or talked to him about this, this line. To support this possibility, we have that letter that we mentioned before. Ricordo, vos signoria, che io di 40 anni son suo. This expression, quarant'anni, is particularly interesting because if we look at the scholarship on Bembo and Colocci, normally this is connected to Bembo's visit to Rome in 1488. But between 1488 and 1539, there are more than 50 years. And in addition, this theory is purely based on the fact that both were in Rome in 1488. If we instead think of the possibility that Bembo and Colocci actually met in 1502, this expression would make a lot more sense because there are almost 40 years between 1539, between 1502 and 1539. Now let us move to the second aim of my presentation, that is showing how Occitan materials could be ideologically reused, or on if we want to interpret this differently, how the knowledge, how the author's mentality could influence their perception of Occitan literature. This is a passage from the Prose in which Bembo imagines the cultural milieu of Occitan poetry. And here, even though he is partially using the de vulgari eloquentia, he is essentially original in this reconstruction. Let us read it together. Era per tutto il ponente la favella provenzale, nei tempi nei quali ella fiorì, in prezzo e in stima molta, e tra tutti gli altri idiomi di quelle parti di gran lunga primiera. Con ciò sia cosa che ciascuno, o francese, o fiammingo, o guascone, o borgognone, o altramente di quelle nazioni che egli si fosse, il quale bene scrivere e specialmente verseggiar volesse, quantunque egli provenzale non fosse, lo faceva provenzalmente. Anzi, ella tanto oltre passò in reputazione e fama, che non solamente catalani, che vicinissimi sono alla Francia, oppure spagnoli più addentro, ma oltre a ciò etiam Dio, alquanti italiani si trova che scrissero e poetarono provenzalmente, e tra questi tre ne furono della patria mia, di ciascuno dei quali io oggi ho letto canzoni, la Franco Cigala, Messer Bonifacio Calvo, e quello che dolcissimo poeta fu, e forse non meno che alcuno degli altri di quella lingua piacevolissimo, Folchetto. So what I found really interesting here is that I think that Bembo is indirectly legitimizing his linguistic theory by showing how things worked in the biggest vernacular literary culture that existed before the Italian one. He is saying that there was one linguistic model that was held in such a high regard and esteem that everyone else who spoke different dialects leveled their language on it purely because of its prestige. And this prestige was not only limited to other to people from the area of Occitania, but also Catalans and Spanish people adopted it, and also some Italians. And I think that by underlining the fact that these Italians were from the same places where the speakers of the dialogue are from, he is saying that his linguistic proposal is not so unheard of, because something very similar had already happened a few centuries before. Or we can also interpret it on the other way around, by thinking that Bembo has such a rigid idea of how linguistic prestige should define the language of literature, that he cannot imagine Occitan culture in any different way than this. So, moving to conclusions, I think I have shown how, by looking at the sources known to Cinquecento scholars and at their knowledge of the language, we can have a clearer idea of the evolution of their Occitan culture and of the materials that were known to them, and which can also perhaps have some consequences on our understanding of their relationships. And on with the second half of this presentation, I think I have shown how the rediscovery of Occitan literature was strictly connected with the linguistic theories connected with the questione della lingua, and how they influenced one another. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Alessandro, for your really fascinating.
Hi, thank you, Charlotte. First of all, I wanted to say how happy I am to be able to present the first results of my thesis in Durham, so to speak, a place that's very close to my heart, both because I was there at the beginning of my master's when I started figuring out what I wanted to do with my life, but also because Annalisa Cipollone had a very important role in the first steps towards defining my research project. So I'm here to talk about the reception of Occitan poetry in 16th century Italy. So let us do some contextualization first. The rediscovery of Occitan poetry in the 16th century is strictly connected with the questione della lingua, with that debate on standards and norms that was a side effect of the lack of political unity in Italy. The questione della lingua, however, also brought a new philological and historical attention to vernacular literature, and also brought with itself a new consideration of the Middle Ages that overcame that humanist behavior of complete dismissal of the Middle Ages. When investigating medieval Italian poetry, 16th century scholars inevitably came across Occitan literature. Here I have just brought the three most notable examples: the translation of Folquet in Giacomo da Lentini, the presence of passages written in Occitan in both the Commedia and the Fragmenta, and the 24 Occitan lines of the Ditta Mondo. But actually, this relationship is much deeper than that. These are just the most notable cases. Now, these rediscovery of Occitan has already been discussed in a very important book published in 1911. This is the 1995 edition by Santorre de Benedetti, Gli studi provenzali in Italia nel Cinquecento. But this book is so in depth that various commentators have said that there's not much more to say about the rediscovery of Occitan. However, in the 100 years that have passed since this book first came out, there have been multiple very important contributions that show us that there is still much to say. Here I would like to propose a couple ways a couple new perspectives to look at this matter that hopefully will bring us to new conclusions. Especially, I would like to focus on how looking in depth at specific passages in these scholars' works can reveal things about their knowledge of Occitan and can even bring some interesting implication with itself. And I would also like to show you how the linguistic ideologies that these authors defended influenced their understanding of Occitan literature. And I would like to do so by focusing on one specific author as an example. And I've picked Pietro Bembo, who of course you will know for his work on the Aldeans as well as for the Prose. And I would like to focus specifically for the first part of this presentation on the Aldean editions of the Fragmenta and the Commedia. That is because, as we have already said, there are passages written in Occitan within these books. So I want to look at these passages to find out what we can infer about what Bembo understood and what materials were available to him at the time of these editions. And we have the manuscripts on which these editions were carried out, which is Vaticano Latino 3197. For the Fragmenta, there has already been a study by Carlo Pulzoni that has shown how much can still be said about Bembo's Occitan knowledge by looking at the Occitan line contained in the Fragmenta, while the Commedia has surprisingly received much less attention. So I would like to show you the passage of the Commedia of Purgatorio 26, in which Dante wrote 8 Occitan lines. Let us read them. This is Bembo's edition on 3197. Tan ma bellis vostre courtois de man, qui eu non puos ne vuelio vos cobrire, jeu sui ernaut che plore vai cantan, con si tost vei la spassada follor, e vei jau sen loigior che sper denan, ara vus preu per aquella valor, che vus guida al som delle scalina, sovegna vos attempts de madolor. Now, authors have theorized that Bembo already knew Occitan quite well at this time. I think that just by looking at the second line from the bottom, we can see that this is definitely not the case. He writes Le Scalina. He uses a masculine article with a feminine name. And in general, he is very passive towards the sources that he is using here. And generally where he distances himself from the already corrupt sources that he has, he just adds more linguistic mistakes. However, there is one thing that is particularly important here, and it is this word here, tan. Indeed, if we look at his two known sources, the first word of this passage is respectively tam and tant. Now, 20 years ago, Donato Pirovano has theorized that Bembo, in establishing the text of the Commedia, also used a third source. that would be the Nido Beato edition of 1477-78. And if we go looking at this edition, we can see that we find effectively tan. However, here Bembo is picking the word that is the most distant from both Italian and Latin. And since we have already ascertained that Bembo is extremely unlikely to have known the language, we have to find an explanation for this weird textual choice. And here are two possible explanations that I found and about which I would really like to hear your feedback. Because I think they're quite convincing, but at the same time, they're also quite conjectural. So let us look at the first explanation. Now, we know that Bembo, in the years when he was working on the Aldines, was very close to the Este family. And in the 1488 inventory of the Este library, we find that an Occitan manuscript, the one nowadays known as E. And this manuscript appears as Liber Fulconis de Marsiglia. Now, the name of Folquet de Marsiglia was definitely known to Bembo, even though at the time he had, as we saw, he had no knowledge of Occitan literature, as Folquet is both in the Commedia and in the Triumphi. And if we can imagine that he was, his curiosity was awakened by these words, so he went to check this book, and even though he didn't know any Occitan at all, he, on the very first page, he could find, right by a minuted initial, these words, tan mabelis. So it might be that he was aware of the existence of the expression, specifically in the version with tan. Now, let us look at the second explanation, which does not necessarily exclude the other, they're not mutually exclusive. The second explanation is connected with a friend of Bembo, Angelo Colocci, another very important 16th century philologist. Colocci and Bembo were very good friends. We have a letter from 1531 where Bembo says that il mio animo è molto vostro insino dalla giovanezza nostra. In another letter from 1539, he says that they have been friends for 40 years. And their friendship also had some consequence on their Occitan interests. Indeed, in 1582, Fulvio Orsini, long after both had died, testifies that he has seen un foglio con una lettera del cardinale Bembo al Colozio, dove gli manda i nomi di tutti i poeti provenzali e i principi di ciascuna cosa che si contiene in detto libro. Therefore, we can admit that to some extent there was the two shared their Occitan findings. So given this background, we know that Bembo in May 1502 was in Rome a few months before publishing the Dante. And in that same period in Rome, there was Benet Garret, a Catalan exile, who was possibly the only person to have some knowledge of Occitan at the beginning of the century. And Cariteo also owned an Occitan manuscript, and we know that he probably brought it to Rome, or at least spoke about it with Angelo Colocci. And if we go looking at his manuscript, which survives, it's the manuscript nowadays known as M, we find that same poem beginning with Tan Mabellis. So what I am proposing here is that when Bembo was in Rome, Colocci and Garret, who were aware that he was working on Dante, showed him or talked to him about this, this line. To support this possibility, we have that letter that we mentioned before. Ricordo, Vos Signoria, che io di 40 anni son suo. This expression, 40 anni, is particularly interesting because if we look at the scholarship on Bembo and Colocci, normally this is connected to Bembo's visit to Rome in 1488. But between 1488 and 1539, there are more than 50 years. And in addition, this theory is purely based on the fact that both were in Rome in 1488. If we instead think of the possibility that Bembo and Colocci actually met in 1502, this expression would make a lot more sense, because there are almost 40 years between 1539, between 1502 and 1539. Now let us move to the second aim of my presentation, that is showing how Occitan materials could be ideologically reused, or on if we want to interpret this differently, how the knowledge, how the author's mentality could influence their perception of Occitan literature. This is a passage from the Prose in which Bembo imagines the cultural milieu of Occitan poetry. And here, even though he is partially using the De Vulgari Eloquentia, he is essentially original in this reconstruction. Let us read it together. Era per tutto il ponente la favella provenzale, nei tempi nei quali ella fiorì, in prezzo e in stima molta, e tra tutti gli altri idiomi di quelle parti di gran lunga primiera. Con ciò sia cosa che ciascuno, o francese, o fiammingo, o guascone, o borgognone, o altramente di quelle nazioni che egli si fosse, il quale bene scrivere e specialmente verseggiar volesse, quantunque egli provenzale non fosse, lo faceva provenzalmente. Anzi, ella tanto oltre passò in reputazione e fama, che non solamente catalani che vicinissimi sono alla Francia, oppure spagnoli più addentro, ma oltre a ciò etiam Dio, alquanti italiani si trova che scrissero e poetarono provenzalmente, e tra questi tre ne furono della patria mia, di ciascuno dei quali io oggi ho letto canzoni, la Franco Cigala, Messer Bonifacio Calvo, e quello che dolcissimo poeta fu, e forse non meno che alcuno degli altri di quella lingua piacevolissimo, Folchetto. So what I found really interesting here is that I think that Bembo is indirectly legitimizing his linguistic theory by showing how things worked in the biggest vernacular literary culture that existed before the Italian one. He is saying that there was one linguistic model that was held in such a high regard and esteem that everyone else who spoke different dialects leveled their language on it purely because of its prestige. And this prestige was not only limited to other to people from the area of Occitania, but also Catalans and Spanish people adopted it, and also some Italians. And I think that by underlining the fact that these Italians were from the same places where the speakers of the dialogue are from, he is saying that his linguistic proposal is not so unheard of, because something very similar had already happened a few centuries before. Or we can also interpret it on the other way around, by thinking that Bembo has such a rigid idea of how linguistic prestige should define the language of literature, that he cannot imagine Occitan culture in any different way than this. So, moving to conclusions, I think I have shown how, by looking at the sources known to 500 scholars and at their knowledge of the language, we can have a clearer idea of the evolution of their Occitan culture and of the materials that were known to them, and which can also perhaps have some consequences on our understanding of their relationships. And on with the second half of this presentation, I think I have shown how the rediscovery of Occitan literature was strictly connected with the linguistic theories connected with the questione della lingua, and how they influenced one another. Thank you for your attention.